Well, our big focus tonight, it's been a bitter, personal and no-holds-barred campaign. And even on the last day today, there was high drama as the Congress released a video which it claims shows the BJP's candidate, Sriramalu, allegedly negotiating with the son-in-law of former Chief Justice of India, KG Balakrishnan, for a bribe in order to get a favourable order in their mining case in the Supreme Court. Amit Shah says the video is fake, but the Congress hit back asking if he was a forensic expert. Justice Balakrishnan's son-in-law, meanwhile, has rubbished the allegations, but the issue has hit the headlines on the eve of these crucial elections.
On the last day of the Karnataka campaign, this video shot in 2010 released by the Congress. The party alleges the video shows BJP candidate Sriramalu trying to strike a deal with former Chief Justice Balakrishna's son-in-law, Sriranjan, to get desired verdict for the reddies in the Supreme Court. The Congress alleges that Sriramalu offered crores as bribe to get a favourable order in a case against Janardhan Reddy, accused of illegal mining on the Andhra-Karnataka border. The Obalapuram mining company, owned by Janardhan Reddy at the time, was fighting the state of Andhra Pradesh. In February 2010, a division bench of the High Court of Andhra Pradesh allowed mining operations by it. This was followed by a hearing in the Supreme Court in March 2010. And finally, on the 10th of May that year, the Supreme Court gave a favourable judgment to the Reddies. Chief Justice Balakrishna retired the next day.
Mr. Modi is protecting the Reddy brothers. He's protecting Mr. Yediyurappa. And Janardhan Reddy is campaigning for BJP. Yediyurappa says that he is a force and he's going to make us win. And secondly, the characters are visible and they are there. And look at the timing of the dates in that video.
The video also has...
The Congress alleges that between January and May 2010, there were a series of meetings between Janardhan Reddy, Sriramalu and three other people, Captain Reddy, Swamiji and Sriranjan, the then Chief Justice's son-in-law. Today, Sriranjan told NDTV it was all rubbish. He said the allegation is purely political. Why has the Congress waited so long? They could have acted when they were in power.
Campaigning may have ended in Karnataka, but the drama certainly hasn't. The Congress now releasing a video which they hope will embarrass the BJP and the BJP candidate for two seats, B. Sriramalu. The BJP has dismissed the video as fake. But all these allegations and counter-allegations just show how seriously the BJP and the Congress are taking the elections in Karnataka 2018. With Govind Murthy, Maya Sharma in Bengaluru for NDTV.
Meanwhile, today, of course, was the final push. Being the last day of campaigning in Karnataka, there were more than 50 BJP leaders who were in the state today. There were chief ministers, 19 union ministers, all of them campaigning. The BJP leaving nothing to chance with more than 50 road shows in the state. Congress also not far behind, with many national party leaders being brought to the state on the last day of campaigning. Meanwhile, Rahul Gandhi responded to Prime Minister Modi's personal jibes against him and his mother, saying that my mother is more Indian than many other people here are, he said, while describing himself as a lightning rod for the PM's anger.
Mr. Modi has anger inside him and he's got anger for everybody, not only for me. I am a lightning rod of that anger. I attract that anger because he sees a threat from me.
Any response you'd like to give to that whole Italian origin, which is being used as a...
My mother is Italian. My mother has also lived larger part of her life in India. She's more Indian than many, many Indian people I see. My mother has sacrificed for this country. My mother has suffered for this country. And it shows the quality of the Prime Minister when he makes these type of comments. It shows the quality of the man. And I'm happy to let him do so. If he enjoys himself, if he likes it, welcome.
Well, Amit Shah, meanwhile, held his own press conference talking of an emphatic BJP win, not the 150 plus that the BJP had initially been talking about, but 130 at least.
कम से कम 130 सीटों से ज्यादा सीट जीतकर भारतीय जनता पार्टी कर्नाटक में सरकार बनाएगी इस बार नरेंद्र मोदी सरकार येदुरप्पा सरकार के साथ चट्टान की तरह खड़ी रहकर कर्नाटक के विकास को वेग देने वाली है क्वेश्चन डज नॉट अराइज सरकार गिरने का पूरे समय के लिए येदुरप्पा जी मुख्यमंत्री
So much excitement on this last day of the Karnataka campaign. Lots to talk about, from this so-called bribery tape that has been released by the Congress to the larger implication of the state election. Is this actually a dress rehearsal for 2019? Is 2019 going to end up becoming a personality contest between Mr. Modi and Rahul Gandhi? All that and much more coming up in the next 60 minutes. Let's go straight across to our panel tonight. We have here in the studio with us Pawan Khera, spokesperson of the Congress, Raghav Avasthi, member of the RSS and lawyer. Journalist and author Niranjan Mukhopadhyay is with us. Ghanshyam Tiwari, spokesperson of the Samajwadi Party. Shashil Namoshi, spokesperson of the BJP, is joining us from Karnataka tonight as well. Let me first take this question of the tapes to you, Pawan Khera. These tapes are supposed to have been shot in 2010. Why have they come out now on the eve of this crucial election?
I'm sure they must have been made available to from wherever they came. That's not as relevant as the content of the tape. The content shows that their star campaigner, Sriramalu, is offering, it is negotiating a deal with the then Chief Justice of India's son-in-law. Let's focus on the content. It's never the timing, it's always the content which is the peg of the news, of any news.
Are you saying the Congress didn't know about this all these years, if this is true?
No, I'm sure we didn't. But the fact of the matter, Nidhi, is that here is your star campaigner. You've shared dais with him. You've shared dais with the Reddy brothers also. But here is another guy who is negotiating on behalf of the Reddy brothers with the son-in-law of the Chief Justice of India. What more can this country tolerate? And this is the ultimate. And I think today is a turning point, not just in Karnataka, but in the rest of the country, where they see the real face of their star campaigner of Karnataka. This is the man who is a favourite of Mr. Amit Shah. He is a favourite of Mr. Narendra Modi. Here he is.
But I just find it a little hard to believe that something that happened in 2010, and forgive me here for coming back to the point on timing, but something that is alleged to have happened in 2010, and then you had the UPA in power for so many years after that, and suddenly this video emerges on the last day of the Karnataka campaign. I mean, the timing is so...
Nidhi,
perfect.
The Reddy brothers are back in business. So is Mr. Ramulu. So is the entire ecosystem of the Reddy brothers. So once this ecosystem gets a life of its own, Mr. Amit Shah and Modi gave them a life. So obviously their rivals must have come out. A lot of things must have happened. Now this is not, I really don't know where it came from. The fact of the matter is that this ecosystem is back in business again. And here we need to expose this ecosystem. This is where...
You're also making a serious allegation of a former Chief Justice of India being bribed for a favourable verdict.
It's for everyone to see.
Because
you can see it on
the verdict was favourable and he retired the next day. But that doesn't mean there was corruption involved.
You can see on the video what happened. You can hear the words. You can hear the figures. You know the outcome of this negotiation which you're watching on television. So what else... Now, you can't expect the then CJI to come and say, I did take it. He'll obviously deny it.
Well, his son-in-law has denied it very strongly. And he's alleged to be...
And Mr. Amit Shah, the great forensic expert, has rubbished it without... Because, of course, they don't have any respect for any agency. Are bhej to dete aap forensic mein pehle hi keh denge. Because they know they run the show.
So, Raghav, on Amit Shah dismissing it as fake, would it actually have been wiser to perhaps... see if it was a fake video actually through forensics? How does he know it's fake?
If the Congress party felt that this video was authentic, they could have had its authenticity checked through a forensic lab before releasing it. And just the fact that they haven't done so, there are private forensic labs also, just the fact that they haven't done so is a dead giveaway that even they're not sure as to the authenticity of the tape. Now, the second point that I would like to make is very important. And I think this whole incident and this affair, it exposes the anti-Dalit mindset of the Congress party. Now, Justice KG Balakrishnan was somebody who belonged to the Dalit community and he made it on his own steam, please, to the post of the Chief Justice. The Dalits all across India are watching. To the post of Chief Justice of India. And the Congress only wants, you know, those Dalits in their ecosystem whom they can patronize. People like Ramnath Kovind or Justice KG Balakrishnan. I mean, the Congress feels that they can slander them and get away with them. And this is highly unfortunate. And as far as the issue of corruption is concerned, I mean, you have the president of their party who very proudly poses for pictures with a certain Mr. Lalu Prasad Yadav, who at last count had been convicted in 4 cases of corruption. But he is a 4-time convict.
Pictures might be a tricky road to walk down on.
He was a 4-time.
Mr. Modi also posed for a picture with Nirav Modi. So
he's a 4-time convict.
I'm making a joke.
There is a difference.
Anyway.
There is a convict. Lalu Prasad Yadav is the only one amongst all of these people who has been convicted 4 times.
Double standards on corruption. You're actually right about that, because that's a fact, and that's across all parties. You have Mr. Yadurappa as the chief ministerial candidate.
Yadurappa has been discharged by the High Court. Mr. Lalu Prasad Yadav has been convicted by 4 courts, and none of his convictions
so
has been stayed.
So is there hypocrisy on corruption?
Qualitatively, Lalu Prasad Yadav's corruption is much greater than that of these
argument.
First, take up the Dalit issue that you
raised, exactly.
And then this corruption issue.
I love this argument. If you expose anybody's corruption, they'll immediately go to his caste. So if they oppose Rahul Gandhi, they're opposing all the voters who belong to that 35 to 50 age group category. I'll also come up with this silly argument of his.
This is
a very stupid argument.
Not a stupid argument at all.
So tomorrow, if I am caught in some corruption, I'll bring out my caste, my religion, whatever, my loyalties, and in case I'm in the BJP, of course, main to doodh ka dhula ho jaunga, because aapke yahan to jaate hi sab, wo koi bhi ho, aapka jo Maharashtra mein aapko join kar gaya, dhul gaya, sab
aap secularism ki university hai, Pawan Kheda ji, aap secularism ki university, aapke
paas
jo aata hai, secular ho
jata hai. Pseudo-nationalism, pseudo-Hinduism, now there is a pseudo-honesty, there is a strange definition, ki Dalit hai, aray sahab, aapko tab to Dalit nahi yaad aata tha. जब आप हमारे सब दलित नेताओं का अपमान करते थे, नो यू डिफीटेड मीरा कुमार, सो यू आर एंटी विमेन, यू हैव इंसल्टेड ऑल द
विमेन. डिफरेंस बिटवीन डिफीटिंग एंड स्लैंडरिंग, यू आर स्लैंडरिंग दिस मैन.
लुक एट द कैंपेन,
यू आर स्लैंडरिंग दिस मैन, सर.
यू आर नॉट
स्लैंडरिंग दिस मैन.
वी आर नॉट स्लैंडरिंग. द वीडियो इज फॉर एवरीवन टू सी.
केडा जी,
द वीडियो इज फॉर एवरीवन टू सी.
नो नो,
आप लोगों ने बंगारू लक्ष्मण के साथ क्या किया?
व्हेन
ही गॉट द लेट श्री बंगारू लक्ष्मण, व्हेन ही गॉट कॉट रेड हैंडेड, तब तो आपने उसको दलित नहीं सोचा, आपको निकाल के बाहर किया. व्हेन योर ओन पार्टी प्रेसिडेंट, हु हैपेंड टू बी अ दलित, बंगारू लक्ष्मण जी, लेट श्री बंगारू लक्ष्मण जी, got caught red-handed. आपने क्यों रिमूव किया?
लक्ष्मण जी
वाज ऑल्सो प्रोटेक्टेड इन योर दलित.
नो नो,
आई वाज स्टैंडर्ड की रक्षा क्यों नहीं की आपने? कैमरा टेकिंग कैश.
दलित की रक्षा क्यों नहीं की उस वक्त आपने?
अरे बट दैट्स नॉट द पॉइंट.
साहब, दलित की रक्षा करने
वन सेकंड
बाहर क्यों निकाला?
अच्छा एक मिनट,
व्हाई वाज बंगारू लक्ष्मण रिमूव्ड?
इफ ही वाज एडिटर ऑफ तहलका, द लिबरल पोस्टर बॉय तरुण तेजपाल वाज लेटर कॉल्ड,
इवन तरुण तेजपाल शुड बी पनिश्ड फॉर व्हाटएवर ही डन
रेपिंग ऑफ वुमन. दिस इज नॉट अबाउट तरुण तेजपाल, वेयर आर यू गाइस गोइंग? ओके ओके, जेंटलमैन वन सेकंड, लेट मी आस्क द बीजेपी. ओके वन सेकंड,
आप हैं
मायावती के अगेंस्ट केस.
ओके पवन, पवन एंड राघव, पवन एंड राघव, जस्ट गिव मी अ मिनट, जस्ट गिव मी अ मिनट, लेट मी जस्ट आस्क द बीजेपी स्पोक्सपर्सन इन कर्नाटका, मिस्टर नामोशी, हुज पेशेंटली लिसनिंग टू दिस. How is this playing out in Karnataka, sir? I want to ask you whether corruption is actually seriously an issue in this election, because you have Mr. Yadurappa as the chief ministerial candidate. Okay, then you have the PM sharing the stage with the Reddys. The Reddy brothers have been given tickets. What is the message that is going out in this election about corruption?
Corruption is definitely an issue in all the elections. There is no doubt about it. But when it comes to corruption, there are a lot of other, you take KG George, or you take many other ministers who are in the Sriramalu's cabinet. They all have been alleged with that. And definitely, there is so much of anti-incumbency in Karnataka that everybody feels the present Sriramalu government is the most corrupt government we have ever seen.
But you are sharing the stage with the Reddys. You are giving them tickets. How are you different? I mean, aren't you meant to be the party with the difference? Aren't you meant to not do what the Congress is doing?
No. Let me be very clear. As far as I don't want to say anything about Janardhan Reddy. But as far as Sriramalu is concerned, we have never seen anything of that sort. And as already mentioned by our national president, it definitely is a fake video. Why I would like to say that is, why this was not played or showed earlier? Why
but
only
how
they,
do you know it's
they
fake?
Bring it on this day?
How do you know it's
why
fake?
Why on the last date of the campaign?
They should certify. I have it certified through a private lab.
But how do you
why
know for sure that it's fake?
It?
Did you test it?
I don't say that I have tested that. But at the same time, why on this day? Why on this day? Why on the last day of the campaign? Why not earlier?
I think it's because their links with the SDP are not now
okay,
exposing
control.
Everybody.
Oh,
wow.
Okay, 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 no. One second. Give me a second.
The P team of the popular front of India.
Let's get back to Karnataka.
Yes, Mr. Sriramalu said that Sriramalu ji is very clean. Let me read his case record that he filed in as an affidavit. He is cases have been framed against on one charge, and then there are multiple cases, seven cases, and these cases related to five charges related to bribery, one charge related to causing hurt, one charge related to attempt to murder, one charge related to criminal intimidation, and the resume is long. So this is the man you are giving clean chit on TV, saying that he is very, very clean. There is no chance. This is a video that needs forensic expertise. Do you think a man with this kind of resume requires a forensic expertise? You know better than other people, and you should not be saying this, giving a clean certificate to this man, given his own affidavit. Either you contest his affidavit. This is the kind of party BJP has become.
Whatever his track record may be, doesn't mean the video is real.
He gave him a clean chit. Yeah. I'm saying it. So you're saying the video is wrong, but the man is right. What is his track record? And look at BJP. Of their candidates, 37% of their candidates have criminal charges. And look at the overall candidates. 207 are crore patis. You have eight of Reddy clan contesting this election. Yediyurappa is your chief candidate. And you say corruption is an issue. Corruption is not an issue. Corruption has become an instrument in Karnataka that is used by BJP with the face and power of Reddy brothers.
All right, I'm going to come back to that point. Raghu, give me a second. Nilanjan, when you look at the way this campaign has panned out, what do you take away from it? Every election that we talk about, every election becomes more bitter. It actually becomes more personal. But on this issue of corruption, how much does it actually matter to people? I mean, it didn't matter in Tamil Nadu. Jayalalitha was still the ultimate leader, despite all the charges she faced. How much does it matter in Karnataka? No. If the PM can share a stage with one of the Reddy brothers, then how much does it matter?
So, Nidhi, I was patiently listening to all my co-panelists. I would say that this discussion has in a way reflected the way the campaign has been conducted. A very bitter, personal, where you constantly raise the volume so that you deflect issues, do not allow sane voices to be, to articulate their thoughts. That has been the general theme of this entire campaign. The few points which have been raised in the point, one is that which you had raised, that why the video now? As a journalist, I would say, why not now? After all, this video would not have had the impact it has had today if it had been released 3 years earlier, 4 years earlier, 3 months earlier. It would not have. This is the final,
I would only disagree with one point. So, that if it was something that was in the knowledge of the Congress when the UPA was in power, and you knew that something had happened, something as serious as this, and you didn't act on it, then that's something that is a grave concern. I don't want to go into the realm of speculation
as to when they had it, but I see it perfectly fine that if they have something which is a potential brahmastra to be used at the moment when you really feel that it is the best thing. Having said that okay, it has had the impact, and whatever is the video is there, and there is really no need to flag a certificate from a forensic laboratory that this is an authentic. The job of getting it authenticated is somebody else's. The purpose of a video is to cause damage. Another comment which I want to make is that, this entire campaign we have been talking about is how it has been run, and right from the beginning, there have been two kinds of campaigns, and I think it's best again reflected in the two press conferences today. One has been Rahul Gandhi's press conference, the other is Mr. Amit Shah's press conference in the evening. They're completely different kind of press conferences. As a journalist, I know, we have seen enough of press conferences. I think the BJP needs to conduct or hold more press conferences. The basic difference is that Rahul Gandhi spoke for about 3 or 4 minutes and allowed the rest of the period and interaction questions to be raised by journalists. In Mr. Amit Shah's case, it was a virtual monologue for about half the time that he was there on air. So I think, it's basically reflective of the way this dispensation treats journalists, not as news gatherers, but as stenographers.
I think this is the way that you basically look at people. It's a very top-down kind of an approach. Right from the beginning in this campaign, you had the BJP presenting one version of everything. One version of nationalism, one leader, one voice. The problem which the BJP has had is on the other side, you have had state-specific issues by the Congress. To counter whatever is happening, the BJP had unleashed the Prime Minister and on the final day, 20-odd ministers. Problem with is that the moment you put in national leaders on a state campaign, you suddenly open yourself not to state-specific
issues,
but you become answerable to all that people feel which a center has not delivered. So suddenly for the BJP, it is not a state election, it becomes a national election.
You don't think it was tactically smart?
So I think that this is an election where they've blundered. In Gujarat, you could have done it with Mr. Modi because he was not the Prime Minister. He was the Gujarat ka dhikro. You could have done it in UP.
Interesting.
He represents UP. He said that main UP wala hun. But you cannot do it in Karnataka. It's a state where in 2013, where he campaigned towards the end, but it really did not have much of an effect.
Well, let me ask Mr. Namoshi about that as a BJP leader from the state. Mr. Namoshi, what do you think about what Nilanjan Mukhopadhyay has just said, that ultimately have the sort of state issues, the local issues that the state faces, have they got sidetracked by this sort of very nationalized campaign?
No, local issues did creep up, and many of the local issues have also come. I was just now mentioning about the corruption in the Sriramalu's government. You can rather say that more than 15 people in his ministry, they have been alleged, and there are details, as you all know, KJ George, he was charged with all type of corruption and all, and within a very short period, he came back again stating that he is right, but again the person who had gone to the court, and the court said no, he has again been alleged that there are some reports are false and all. This is what has been told by the court also.
You're not answering the question of...
The case has been admitted.
No, but...
What I want to say did you
bombard Karnataka with too many national leaders? It actually may work perfectly all right for the BJP because we don't know what will happen or when people go out to vote. But did it just become too much focused on leaders from elsewhere, from Delhi?
It is a common thing. It's a common thing because we have a government in the center. Many of our leaders... no national leaders, they have come for the campaign. What is wrong? And we are within number of this thing. We have not done any mistake of any kind, not against the election rules or
within your purview, what kind of campaign style you want to watch. Raghu, give me a second. I just want to take another point that Nilanjan raised on the press conferences and the personalized campaign. And Pawan, let me talk to you about that. This whole thing about bringing in Sonia Gandhi's origins, etc. We saw what Rahul Gandhi said today. Why is the campaign with each election though becoming more and more bitter? I mean, one fears for what will happen in the general election if the discourse is so coarse and so debased right now. What's going to happen in the next 1 year?
This has been an unprecedented kind of a degradation of political discourse amongst political rivals. It's never been like this. And I'm sorry, the responsibility and the onus lies with Mr. Modi and Mr. Amit Shah. They don't somehow understand how to coexist with rivals. They can't tolerate rivals. Congress Mukt Bharat is the first sign of what they have in their mind. Vipaksh hona hi nahi chahiye. Supreme Court Mukt Bharat, Media Mukt Bharat. What do you want? Where will you stop? Sabhi ko hata dijiye to aap hi. As you rightly said, one kind of thought, one ideology. Rahul this morning also said one ideology, one idea, sab kuch jo wo chahe, that is the ultimate. Ab press conference karne ki himmat hai nahi kyunki batane ko kuch hai nahi. Rahul Gandhi comes out openly, takes questions kyunki chhipane ko kuch nahi hai. So that's a major difference. Now top down is very well described by my friend Nilanjan here. Yes, jo maine keh diya, that's the final word. Nobody can question you. I remember some interviews which Mr. Modi gave as a chief minister, and he just walked out of the interviews because the questions were tough. A leader who cannot handle tough questions, who hates to respond, who only loves to sermonize and pontificate, he can't be a leader in a democratic country. He cannot be a leader of India, at least.
So, Raghav, let's just take on that point about the personalization of the campaign. I mean, aren't we kind of done with the whole Italian origins debate now?
But I will tell you one thing. There are very important questions that need to be asked. I think there is one very important question that I need to ask Rahul Gandhiji, which is that he is really proud of his mother. Is he also proud of his grandfather who fought for Benito Mussolini when the Italians, when the Italian people...
Why are you saying that? How is that
substantial? Are you proud of the RSS to join hands with the British?
He keeps talking about fascism. He keeps talking about fascism. He should disown the fascist antecedents of his grandfather. He should disown Pavanji.
No, this is not fair.
He should disown the fascist antecedents of his grandfather
and the fascist antecedents
of his Italian Italian maternal family.
Nobody reads history anymore.
The domain as well.
Compulsory.
Nobody is reading history anymore.
The people of Italy were fighting.
Can I get Nilanjan to comment on this? One second, please. Raghav, one second.
They have no history to question.
What are we talking about here, yaar? This is exactly what the Karnataka campaign has been reducing. Raghav, one second. Let Nilanjan. Let Nilanjan say
something. That's your story.
You know, I just want to say something. I really do not know if Sonia Gandhi's father, you know, was
actually... I don't know either.
I don't know. I just want to tell say something. I have been really recently doing some research on the connections of the RSS in the 1930s with the fascists in Italy. You know, and I have been studying Mr. Munje's, B.S. Munje's, who was Hedgewar's guru, visit in Italy and where all he had been traveling. Now, that is also one point which I read. At that time in Italy, there was compulsory enlisting in the army and in the fascist army. Exactly. And it impressed Mr. Munje and he came back. And just a second, Raghav. And he came back and they discussed it. And in fact, the Bhonsale military school which was started as primarily in the same model as the Italian fascist schools.
So let's not have a debate about anybody's fascist antecedents.
I think that was a compulsory. Youth had to compulsorily enlist in the army Hitler. At that time.
You see all the books.
There's a difference obsession between Hitler and Mussolini.
There's a difference in Hitler and Mussolini. They do not care what Rahul
Gandhi did. I don't want to talk about that difference. Please, God.
I'm glad he's supporting Hitler openly. I'm very happy.
Can we talk about the issues? No. Not just
Hitler. Very bright future.
People in Karnataka do not care.
How is this relevant to the people? I want to know. Rahul Gandhi
likes to talk a big game about fascism. He should tell us if he disowns the fascist antecedents of his grandfather.
Why are you making this campaign so coarse and so personal?
Because Rahul Gandhi keeps talking about creeping fascism. Rahul Gandhi is the one who keeps talking about creeping fascism and one party rule and whatnot. So you should also tell us whether he disowns it.
We are talking about the unemployment in this country.
I've seen the love that you have for the
farmers in this country.
You are slandering
about rapes in this country. The moment we say women's safety,
why are the BJP's own Dalit MPs are revolting against you?
I want to ask you, let's talk about Savarkar, let's talk about Ghanshyam, one of the things
Ghanshyam that has emerged, and you are an important person here today because you are an ally of the Congress. Okay, now whatever Rahul has said about his prime ministerial possible, I mean, he didn't really talk about ambitions as such. It was more couched than the way it was reported initially. But was it a mistake for Rahul to say that? Do you think it was a mistake? Do you think it will scare away other parties from coming together? And do you think then the election will end up becoming Rahul versus Modi, or you just have to wait and see?
No, I think I don't think it was a mistake. The 2019 campaign is going to be, as it would start from Karnataka on 12th, is going to be an unvote BJP campaign. And unvote BJP because they did not fulfill their promises, because they misled the country. The Prime Minister right at the highest level misled the country on critical issues and distracted the nation. As a result, it is important that different tall leaders present their vision for the country, and they can present their vision saying that, you know, this is my vision, this is why I think I would be a candidate for the Prime Minister. If you look at Nidhi, in the last 2 years, the opposition, all the parties have met on different platforms, be it elections of the president or other platforms. And never ever have the agenda of who the leader would be has come to the fore. It
but
is always about what the agenda of 2019 is going to be.
I mean, he's in a very roundabout way, but if we look at
how opposition looks. You have Mamata Banerjee, you have Akhilesh Yadav, you have Sharad Pawar, you have Rahul Gandhi, you have some KCR. Leaders, you have KCR, whose work, whose credibility, whose life is transparent, and you can present Bahanji that work. If you have a team like this leading India, you know that they would elect the right leaders and they will not talk through
so
their
head.
So
you didn't see Rahul's statement as a kind of claim by him to this position. You didn't see it like
no,
that?
No, I think Akhilesh Yadavji has clearly said that he has a great friendship with Rahul Gandhi and we as a party have a great friendship with Congress party and we have always welcomed young leaders presenting their vision and aspiration to serve India. We don't see anything wrong in this claim. We have always believed that the opposition today is very mature, is focused on the unvote BJP campaign and an agenda for India for 2019.
Okay,
because
you may say
last
that,
5 years
but
have been
know,
a mess.
Just a very quick numerical fact,
if you look at all elections, you know, right from 96 onwards, the BJP and the Congress combined, they win about 320 seats. So at the moment, the BJP has 280 and the Congress has 40 odd. Now, if the BJP starts coming down, obviously those seats, and we can presume that by and large this election, this equation will remain the same. So you have 250 odd seats which go to other parties. Between these two parties, they are going to have 300 plus seats. So if the BJP comes down, naturally the Congress is going to be a fairly significant enough party. Now, I'm not saying that the moment you have become a significant enough party, Rahul Gandhi is going to stake his claim to become prime. So maybe not. Maybe we might see a repeat of 96 kind of an election. That is
was it smart to have said
I
that?
Think
he
it was,
he,
I think
could
it
he
was,
have just said it's for something, no, it's not for us to talk about
the
right
way
now.
I look at it, I have gone back and seen the entire video and the interaction. I think he's being very smart. He's saying that let's have a platform where everybody come in. The Congress will provide a platform. But he's nowhere saying that, you know, I want to become. He says if we have the numbers and whoever is the largest, there will be some kind of a discussion. It could be me, but he's not saying I will be the one. There's a difference between what was there in 2014 for Mr. Modi that he will be the one. And here the Congress is not saying that he will be the one.
The problem is, Pawan, today you've had, for example, a Mamata Banerjee fan page, okay, on the internet, which I think has got the blessings of the TMC. No, so now that suddenly he's got Mamata's picture. Let's have our first Bengali Prime Minister. So, does this have the potential to create that kind of flutter amongst your potential allies? Was this the right time to have said something?
No,
like
I
this?
Don't think it will create any flutter. We have very mature people, and we just heard a very mature voice from Samajwadi Party. So, I'm sure the BJP hates listening to these sane, wise words from Ghanshyam Tiwari. These are the people jinki do seatein aati hain, sarkar banane chale jaate hain. Nagaland mein hua hai. Goa mein they lose elections, they form the government. Rahul Gandhi just said, wait please. Rahul Gandhi just said, if the numbers are there, why not? What is so wrong? Arey saab, jo Aditya Nath jo apne aapko yogi kehte the, Ajay Singh Bisht, yogi sab neta ban sakta hai aur mukhyamantri ban sakta hai without being projected. Lekin rajneeti mein jo hai, wo pradhanmantri nahi ban sakta. Kyun saab? Why? दो सीटें वाले बना देते हैं सरकार. यू लूज इलेक्शन इन गोवा मिजरेबली. यू लूज मिजरेबली इन गोवा. गो एंड फॉर्म द गवर्नमेंट. गो एंड फॉर्म द गवर्नमेंट एज इफ इट्स योर बर्थ राइट.
नो, ही इज नॉट सेइंग दैट.
48 में आपका लैंड एक्विजिशन बिल का हालत देखी थी आपने. 48 सीट्स इन पार्लियामेंट. तब तो 44 थी. व्हेन वी हैड जस्ट 44 सीट्स इन पार्लियामेंट, योर प्राइम मिनिस्टर कुड नॉट गेट द लैंड एक्विजिशन बिल पास. एक्सेप्टेबिलिटी ऑल नो व्हाट हैपेंड. हमें असलियत मालूम है, आपको भी मालूम है. ये एरोगेंस मत रखिए.
वी हैव दिस
We have this
Pawan and Raghav sort of jewel bandi which comes in between. Okay, one second, hold on. But Raghav, you still haven't answered my question. Why does the campaign have to be so personalized?
It doesn't have to be personalized at all.
Is it?
But it is Mr. Rahul Gandhi who keeps bringing up the specter
not,
of fascism.
He's not made any
when
personal
yes, he does.
Attack
when and it does
Modi?
Not have to be personal. The fact of the matter is that, you know, there is this one party which is known as the Congress party which has become the sole proprietorship of one family, and the people of India have risen up in revolt against them. And since the people of India have risen up in revolt against the politics of dynastic entitlement, it is incumbent upon
but
the Prime Minister
elections.
Of India.
What is dynastic entitlement?
There
I
is
mean,
dynastic entitlement
he
because
actually,
Mr. Shahzad
he actually won
right
by
now,
a
higher, lesser number of votes.
कौन सा चुनाव लड़के अपनी पार्टी का प्रेसिडेंट दूसरा टर्म बने हैं जरा बताइए. अमित शाह पैनल विद मी यस्टरडे. बीजेपी में अमित शाह कैसे अध्यक्ष बने, कौन सा चुनाव जीते पार्टी का. राहुल गांधी विंस द इलेक्शन विद द पार्टी.
शैम इलेक्शन वाज.
अरे आप शैम करके दिखा दीजिए. अमित शाह का शैम इलेक्शन.
अगेन नॉट आंसरिंग योर क्वेश्चन अबाउट लिस्ट. ओके घनश्याम, मे बी यू कैन आंसर इट. व्हाई इज इट सो, आई मीन Is this the sort of signature style that it's going to be? That it is, you know, that if it's personal, then it'll catch more eyeballs.
I think reason it is personalized, and you can also see a pattern in Prime Minister making mistakes with history, inventing history in some cases. The reason it is personalized.
Today
is
he said that Nehru didn't ever visit Bhagat Singh in jail. Yeah. It's not true, yeah. By the way.
So and then Mohanlal Karamchand Gandhi and there are many others, right? But the thing is that the reason it is personalized is January 3, 2014 was the last time an Indian Prime Minister ever did a press conference. When a Prime Minister starts believing in a one-way conversation, when he's not ready to be addressed, questioned by anybody, then he has no accountability. Today, the reason why our institutions have been diminished or limped is because this government has gone into an unaccountable mode where nobody does a press conference, nobody takes citizens seriously, press seriously, institutions seriously. As a result, you can have a hit-and-run campaign where you can say anything about a Prime Minister on conspiring against the nation, an ex-Vice President on conspiring against the nation, or somebody's mother, or their origins, or somebody as a young leader, because you can just go ahead, say what you want to say, and close down but your doors, not answer.
So Raghav, that's a point actually that Rahul Gandhi raised at his press conference today. And do you think that as we get into election year, right before the general elections, I think a lot of people would want to hear the Prime Minister take on questions, no holds barred, answer everything as voters.
It's a very good question, and I would like to answer it. And I would request Mr. Kheda to let me complete my sentence this time, because then I'll also have to start telling nobody will be able to hear anything. The fact of the matter is that when Mr. Manmohan Singh was Prime Minister, he is the kind of sham that the press conferences were, where friendly journalists were planted to ask questions about India's World Cup victory. All of that is well documented.
Where is that? When did that happen?
All of that is well documented. Where? Mr. Arnab Goswami has talked about it in detail.
Dr. Manmohan Singh had a press conference every time he travelled abroad, as did Mr. Vajpayee on the aircraft. And you could ask him any question, anything from domestic politics to international relations to anything. It's actually sad that he didn't have those press conferences more often outside of the aircraft. But he did it on every single trip.
No, but this was a PR exercise. Press conference that I'm talking about, I'm which took about place in 2011.
In general. Why? I mean, and also, Manmohan Singh was voted out of power for a reason.
Exactly. He was voted out of power because of incompetence.
Therefore, there is no need
for Narendra Modi ji to follow Mr. Manmohan Singh's playbook.
Every democratic world leader does a press conference, takes questions.
I think he doesn't have to follow democracy. Come on,
Narendra Modi. Kheraji, I'll also have to start yelling. The viewers will just switch.
Kheraji,
this is not
Manmohan Singh was incompetent.
Manmohan Singh ji was incompetent. That is why he was booted out. And that is the reason why your party.
You can't match the job figures. You sunk the economy. Demonetization. You cannot implement the GST. And you say Manmohan Singh was incompetent. We've seen what's happening in China. All our neighbors are going in the lap of China. This is your foreign policy. We don't even know who is running your foreign policy. Is it the NSA? Is it the foreign
policy? Okay, round 4 is over. Round 4 is over. Or is it round 5? Okay, one second.
You are a disaster on the economic front.
We were talking about the Prime Minister answering questions.
Pradhan Mantri China gaya bina agenda ke.
Nilanjan. Okay, thank you. Gentlemen, guys,
China ja rahe hain. Desh ke taxpayer ke paise pe ja rahe hain.
Aap unka haath pakad lijiye, main inka haath pakad lunga. Nilanjan. Okay. Ceasefire.
As a person who's biographed the Prime Minister, I have a favorite Narendra Modi and the media story.
And look, he's done a biography of Mr. Modi.
It's a Narendra Modi and the media story. Now, in Gujarat, you know, Gandhinagar and Ahmedabad are twin cities, about 20-25 kilometers away. There used to be a tradition, I think it was started sometime around Keshubhai Patel's time, that when journalists, most of them who stayed in Ahmedabad, they would have to go to Gandhinagar. So there was a bus facility for them to go to Gandhinagar. A bus would start from a common point in Ahmedabad and go to Gandhinagar to allow journalists to be there the whole day, go around various ministries and come back in the evening so that they could come back to their offices and do the stories. Within a week of Mr. Modi becoming the Prime Minister, this bus service was shut. What does this show? that a minor thing like a bus service which facilitates journalists to be able to do the job is not allowed because some loophole is found, some clearances has not been provided. Similarly, immediately after becoming the Prime Minister, what happens is that foreign trips and journalists get delinked. Fair enough, you know, you are entitled to take decisions. You also decide that we are going to use social media for direct contact with the people. You start Mann Ki Baat. So there's this right from the beginning, there has been an approach to bypass the media and reach out to the people directly.
Yet you do.
So I think this is also reflective of the press conference today, that it is not interactive as much as the other parties. It is more of a monologue. So this is the basic difference between the BJP and
is this going to become a personality contest next year? Even if the opposition doesn't announce a candidate to take on Mr. Modi, is it inevitable that it's going to become Rahul versus Modi?
It has been a personality contest, and so far Mr. Modi has been winning it. But as we say, you know, everything has a certain limited life. I think this is also running thin. So it is time that you have to make yourself available to more. That people want to hear Mr. Modi. People want to want their questions to be answered, which are not
rather than one-way communication.
The Karnataka elections is, will mark a watershed moment because of two reasons. One, this would be the first election if BJP loses. This would be the first election where they have gone in, sold their promises as a voice of opposition, and then lost the elections. If they loses, if they lose in other elections, be it Tripura or other places, they came in as a voice of opposition, said the incumbent government is not performing, and as a result, they won the election selling good dreams. That is one. Second is that is the doorway to the south. If Karnataka shuts its door on BJP, then you know where Tamil Nadu stands, you know where Kerala stands, you know where Andhra Pradesh stands, you know where Telangana stands. If it shuts the door on the Congress, then it will have a huge ramification on 2019. The entire claim of Congress leadership for 2019 would look shaky, yeah. and BJP would use this victory to say that this is a validation of Prime Minister's 4 years of misrule, in my opinion.
Well, then Pawan, would you admit that Karnataka, in a sense, is maybe even more crucial for the Congress than it is for the BJP?
I think all elections, Congress where we are, every election is crucial for us. You saw it in Gujarat.
The indictment of his leadership.
Let him complete.
Let him finish.
You want to say something else, please?
Let him finish.
I think you need a promotion in RSS. You better speak. Maybe it helps.
No, Pawan, finish speaking.
It will help you, sir. I hope you become minister in the next government.
Let him join the NDTV. He's an anchor right now.
Go ahead.
So every election is important. We saw the sweaty foreheads of Amit Shah and Modi ji in Gujarat, their own backyard, Gujarat no dikro, as my friend rightly said it. 150 seat, Amit Shah would very proudly announce. And what was the campaign style of Mr. Modi there? Agar Congress ban gayi, to Pakistan mein nirnay ho chuka hai ki Musalman mukhyamantri ban gaye. This is the Prime Minister of India speaking. Jinhone samvidhan ki shapath li hai, unki ye zuban hai ki agar Congress jeeti Gujarat mein to Musalman mukhyamantri banega, Pakistan mein decision hua hai.
Shukar hai thoda kam Pakistan.
Agar aisi personality se contest hoga to maaf kijiyega, fir hame badi khushi hai. Ye personality ab nikal kar aa rahi hai, nikhar kar aayi hai Pradhan Mantri ji. We are very happy having a personality contest with this man, who's showing the true personality of his election after election, election after election. 2014, it was a new face. He was fresh. People were angry with the Congress, I admit, and we lost. Now, people are not just angry with this government. They have seen the true personality of this government. So, therefore, they are exposed.
I think what we can all agree on is that this is an important election for all the parties involved. It has huge national repercussions for both the BJP and the Congress because we are heading into a year where the general elections, of course, take place exactly a year from now. But you also have other crucial state elections later this year, which I think Ghanshyam will also, because they are BJP versus Congress contests, will also play an important role in determining what the Congress's position is in any bigger alliance for 2019. Thank you very much to all our panelists for joining us on this comprehensive debate tonight.